So once again, the bad behavior of the explicit coupling can be explained by this added mass effect, which is mainly linked to the uncompressibility constraint. So we go back to the example I gave you on 2 days ago, which illustrates rather well this effect. So take a perfect 2D fluid in a fixed domain coupled to a wave equation or on the boundary, on one part of the boundary, and take the divergence of the first equation and then take the normal component of the first equation, and you end up with an equation on the pressure, and so it solves a Laplace equation. And with a Neumann boundary condition depending on the acceleration of the structure and on the mass of the fluid. And so the structure equation can be condensate in a single, so the total coupled fluid structure coupled problem can be condensate in an equation for the displacement of the structure only, thanks to the added mass operator, which is an operator that takes the normal derivative of the pressure and gives the trace of the pressure on the interface. So this is a Steklov-Poincaré operator. This is a symmetric self-adjoint and compact operator because it goes from h minus 1 over 2 into h 1 over 2. So this is a compact operator, so it has a sequence of strictly positive eigenvalue, decreasing eigenvalue. And if you discretize the structure equation with a leapfrog scheme for the time derivative of the structure velocity, and if you treat the added mass in an explicit way, then if rho s is small with respect to the density of the fluid times the highest eigenvalue of the operator MA, then you will end up with a non-stable scheme, whatever you do, even if delta t goes to zero. So there is a range of physical parameter where you cannot use explicit schemes. Okay? So why? So in the same way, you cannot perform a fixed point theorem to prove existence of solution. You cannot treat explicitly the added mass. So it was eta. So d is equal to eta. So I take a leapfrog. I discretize the added mass in an explicit way. So the first part is implicit, and the operator MA acts on the acceleration from the previous time step. Okay, so this is an explicit scheme. You treat explicitly the scheme, the underlying scheme is solve the fluid equation with a velocity coming from the previous time step, and then solve the structure part. So this is really a Dirichlet-Neumann scheme associated to the coupled fluid structure problem. And next, you decompose the displacement thanks to the basis of eigenfunction linked to the operator MA, which is a self-adjoint compact operator. Okay, so phi I are the eigenfunction. This is a basis. And so you can decompose the displacement of the structure in this basis. And by doing so, you obtain an equation, a scalar on each coefficient, okay? And so you don't have anymore the operator MA, but you see appearing the eigenfunction, the eigenvalue of this operator. Okay, mu I are the eigenvalue of the operator MA, the added mass operator. And yeah, I took a simple elastic energy, so the to simplify. And if you do the analysis of this scheme, the associated characteristic polynomial write like this. And what you can see is that if you have this condition satisfied, then there exists a root of the polynomial that is strictly less than minus one. So it means that the scheme will not be stable, okay? And here you see that this condition may be satisfied even if delta t equal to zero. In the case where, so rho s over rho f is less than the maximum eigenvalue of the operator MA, then you will have an unstable scheme, no matter what you do, and even if delta t goes to zero. Yes? Because you will have some root that is strictly less than minus one. Is it clear? So this is really simple. And it explains blob this. And the fact that here the eigenvalue depends on the length and the diameter of the cylinder. So it depends on the geometry, and so you will have trouble if you have a long cylinder than if you have a short one. I think it's in this way. But okay. So here, the idea is to treat in an implicit way the added mass effect. As I presented you for the existence of strong solution in the proof of Julien Lecoeur, he split the velocity in two, the pressure in two, and in the sketch of the way he proved the regularity and the existence of the solution, he proved it by keeping the added mass effect implicit, and the other part is treated explicitly. So the idea is to treat the main part of the added mass in an implicit way. And so to compute the pressure, the fluid pressure, implicitly, and to treat the viscous effect explicitly. And to treat the nonlinear terms coming from the geometrical nonlinearity in an explicit step to keep the system simple to solve, all the nonlinearities will be put in the explicit step. So, in fact, this can be achieved thanks to a splitting scheme for the fluid part. And for instance, with the Shorin-Temam scheme, I will explain what is the Shorin-Temam scheme. But by doing so the pressure is treated implicitly, whereas the viscous terms are treated implicitly. So in the energy balance, you will have some spurious energy coming from the explicit treatment of the viscous term. Yeah? You will not have the pressure appearing because the pressure will be treated implicitly, but you will have some spurious energy, which is written there. And so, to guarantee that the scheme remains stable, we will have to control this porous energy. And we hope to control this porous energy. Okay? So the implicit scheme will be cheap because all the nonlinearity are treated explicitly. And so first, we start to extrapolate the geometry and the mesh velocity. So we will treat the geometry explicitly. And we will, so the Shorin-Temam scheme has two steps. One viscous step, where you compute a velocity which is not divergence free, and one projection step to make a correction to this velocity to guarantee the incompressibility constraint. So the first step is written here, where in fact you don't have a pressure. You only have a convection diffusion equation to solve, and you will solve it in every nonlinearities are in this equation. You have the nonlinear term coming from the convection term, and what we impose at the interface is the equality of the velocity, but in an explicit way. So we impose that u tilde n plus 1 is equal to the velocity of the structure coming from the previous time step. So knowing the quantity at time n delta t, you can solve this equation and compute the velocity u tilde n plus 1. Yes? But this velocity is not divergent free, so you are making an error there, and you have to project this velocity on the divergence-free space. So the second step is to project this velocity on the divergence-free space. And so this is a projection step where you will calculate a new velocity that is divergence-free, u n plus 1, and the pressure associated to the fluid p n plus 1. So at this step, you correct the velocity and you calculate the pressure. And this problem is the same as... So this is the discrete counterpart to yes. This is exactly. and so here, the boundary condition you take to solve this problem are implicit boundary conditions. You impose that the fluid velocity you compute, the normal trace of this fluid velocity and u n plus 1, you impose to be equal to the structure velocity, but at the current time step. So this is an implicit treatment of the boundary condition. Then you have to compute the forces applied by the fluid on the structure. So the viscous term is computed through u tilde n plus 1, which was computed thanks to the convection diffusion step, and with pn plus 1 coming from this projection step. So you have a semi-implicit coupling because you have an explicit coupling for the diffusion and an implicit coupling for the projection step. And this implicit coupling can be achieved thanks to sub-iteration at each time step, for instance. Okay, fixed point or something like that, or fixed point plus relaxation, stuff like that. This part, that part of the fluid and the structure are solved together at the same time step. So, and this can be achieved thanks to an iterative procedure. So, here it's cheap because cheap, except for the inner iteration at each time step. It is rather cheap because here you have an explicit step with all the nonlinearities in this step. And here you have an implicit step, but in fact you don't solve the Darcy problem you have there. You solve the Laplace equation on P. So you have fast solver to solve this equation. Okay? So this step is rather, even if you have you have to do some subcycling and stuff like that, this step may be rather cheap. And then so the step which is not cheap is the fact that you call the structure solver in those sub-iterations, and the structure solver may be really costly because you may have some nonlinear structure and stuff like that. So the trouble is that here you are solving the fluid in a cheap manner, but because of the for instance the nonlinearity of the structure and stuff like that, the call to the structure solver may be really, really costly. So here, this is only the fluid part that is cheap because of the call of the structure solver in the iteration in order to have an implicit coupling for the projection step. So the projection is performed in a given domain. The system is linear if the structure is linear. So if the structure is not linear, the system is not linear. And the implicit coupling requires cheap, if we forget the call to the solver, structure solver, cheap inner iterations. And what we can prove on this scheme is that it is stable under a no-full condition that involves the density of the fluid, the density of the structure, but also the mesh size of the fluid and the mesh size of the structure. So capital H is the, so we are able to prove that the scheme is stable only by considering a full discretized problem. So we discretize it in time and in space with finite element approximation. Okay? We are not able to prove that this scheme is stable with only time discretization. So we need to have a full discretized problem, space and time, to prove that the scheme is stable. And so some comments on the condition. So it is not independent of the added mass effect, because you see that you have rho s and rho f appearing in the condition. So capital H is a space mesh size of the fluid, and small h, the one of the structure. So we assume that we may have some non-matching grids at the interface, okay, between the fluid and the structure. And in the case where the structure is a thin structure and the fluid is a thick one, then you can take H equal capital H and obtain stability. Stability means that the energy of the system at time n is less than the energy of the system at time zero multiplied by some exponential of t, where t is the time of the simulation. In the case where we have a thick structure coupled to a thick fluid, then we have to have some additional constraint on the space mesh size. And in particular, we have to have a finer mesh size for the structure than for the fluid. So this is not really satisfactory from the theoretical point of view. We are not able to prove that the scheme behaves independently of the added mass effect. And we are not able to prove that with matching grids at the interface, it's always stable. Okay, in particular, if you have a thick structure. So and we have CFL-like conditions. Delta T have to be small with respect to the mesh size. Okay. So the idea of the proof is the following. To prove that a scheme is stable, is as we did for the implicit scheme, or as we did at the continuous level, we would like to take the velocity of the fluid as a test function and the velocity of the structure as test function. Nevertheless, we have a gap between the equality of the velocity at the interface, because one step is explicit. So in particular, the second velocity, which corresponds to the first one, U tilde, doesn't match the velocity of the structure at time n plus 1 because of the explicit coupling. So we have extra term to control. So you have to do a correction to this velocity in order to have matching at the interface between the free test function and the structural test function. So we correct the velocity of the fluid by this red extra term there. That is, in a way, will be proportional to delta t times the acceleration of the structure. Yes? And so we have to control this extra term in the variational formulation. And we have to be sure that this extra term will not make the scheme unstable. And in fact, to control this extra term, we need to have to use inverse inequality. So to compare the H1 norm of the red quantity here to the L2 norm. So it makes appear a 1 over H. And this is why we have those 1 over H and stuff like that appearing. Okay? And this is the reason why we cannot do the analysis for the semi-discretized in time only scheme. Okay? Because we have to control this extra term in H1 norm in particular. And to control this extra term in H1 norm, because we don't control the acceleration of the structure in H1, we control it in L2. So we have to use an inverse inequality to go from H1 to H2. This inverse inequality makes 1 over H appearing. And so this is the reason why we are not able to prove that this scheme, the semi-discrete scheme is stable, but only the full discretized one. One remark here: I choose the leapfrog scheme, not the Newmark one, and the leapfrog scheme dissipate a lot the energy. And this extra term is controlled thanks to the dissipation of the new leapfrog scheme. If I take the Newmark scheme, which conserves the energy of the structure, then I will not be able to control this term. So from the theoretical point of view, it's a bit, we are not so happy with this result, because we have to have non-matching grids in some case, and we have to choose a scheme for the structure that dissipates enough the energy in order to control the extra terms. So this is not really satisfactory. So we did also a convergence analysis for this scheme. So we prove that so we have a non-matching grid. So at the interface, we have a matching operator pH that enables to transfer the information from one grid to another. And depending on the matching operator, we may or may not have some optimal estimates in space for the error. And in time, we have only a square root of delta t. But here, this is only due to the Shorin-Temam scheme, because the Shorin-Temam scheme, the convergence rate is only in square root of delta t. So no surprise there. The Shorin-Temam scheme, the error behaves like that, and our coupled scheme behave like exactly in the same way. So what is so the performance of the on voit rien du tout of the algorithm? So we compare here the projection scheme, the implicit scheme, and some explicit scheme, and what is compute is the energy, the sparse energy at the interface. So for the explicit scheme, in the case where you have a strong added mass effect, then you see that this energy, sparse energy at the interface increase, Whereas for the implicit scheme and the projection scheme, you control this porous energy at the interface. So that means that the scheme is stable. And if you decrease the added mass effect, then every scheme behaves well, and the explicit scheme as well, because then you are outside the range where the added mass effect may cause some trouble. From the computational point of view, we have some gain in the CPU time, but in fact, not so much because of the core of the solid solver. Okay, but nevertheless, it's less costly than an implicit scheme or so from the theoretical point of view, we have few drawbacks, I will say. You have non-matching grid, CFL conditions, the ratio between the density appearing and stuff like that. Nevertheless, from the practical point of view, it works, even with matching grids. And even if you have the density of the structure close to the density of the fluid. So we are not able to prove it, but in the range of application we are considering, it behaves well. Maybe in another range of application, it will not work, surely. Otherwise, the result is not optimal. But the result may not be optimal. And even so, the structure here, for instance, is discretized by a Newmark scheme. You don't want the structure to dissipate energy in a real application. And it works. And we are not able to show that it works with a pen. But in practical application, it works. And we have some gain in the CPU time compared to implicit scheme. When I say implicit scheme, it's a coupling between the fluid and the structures that is implicit, not the geometry. Geometry is treated explicitly. Okay. So to summarize, we have a first step, advection diffusion with ALE, all the nonlinear term. This step is coupled explicitly with the structure, and we have the projection step to correct the velocity, and this projection step, which contains the added mass, is the main part of the added mass, because here the analysis shows that the condition of stability is not independent of the ratio of the density. So from this point of view, this is not really satisfactory. The scheme is not stable for every parameter we may choose. So this is not really a scheme that is independent of the added mass effect. This is based on a standard Dirichlet-Neumann splitting, in fact. Okay. So next, I will speak about some results from Miguel Fernandez and co-workers. And so they add the idea to here, the Dirichlet boundary conditions are enforced in a strong way. And he had the idea to enforce it in a weak way thanks to niche methods. So I don't know if you know what is niche methods. No, yes, yes, no, no. So the standard Dirichlet-Neumann boundary condition formulation on a really simple case, so take the Laplacian equation, and you split your domain in two, omega 1 and omega 2, you have in an interface between an interface sigma between omega 1 and omega 2. So solving the Laplace equation in omega 1 and omega 2 with the equality U1 equal U2 on the interface and the equality of the the Neumann boundary conditions here on the interface is completely equivalent to the solve the the elliptic equation on the whole domain. So on the interface, you have what will correspond to the equality of the velocity and the action reaction principle, the second equation. So when you consider conforming a Dirichlet-Neumann formulation, so you multiply the first equation satisfied by U1 by V1, which is zero on the interface, so that you do not see the other part. And next, you will solve the equation corresponding to U2 by considering a test function that is not zero on the interface. So you will have, so if I integrate by part, you will have omega 1 U2 V2 minus sigma U2 over dn V2. And this is equal to du1 over dn. And if I lift V2, the trace of V2 in omega 1, I recover that this term is exactly equal to this one, minus this one. Okay? Those are just integration by parts. And so by adding, so this is the same formulation I showed you before for the first part was the fluid, and the second part was the structure. And here this is the residual of the part coming from omega 1. Okay? This is exactly the same formulation, but on a simpler problem. And so by adding those two formulations, you recover the full coupled formulation. Okay? So this is, in fact, the standard Dirichlet-Neumann splitting. That does not work. So the niche method, in fact, consists in saying, okay, I will not enforce the equality of the velocity in a strong way, but in a weak manner. And I will add to the formulation the term gamma over h. So h is the space mesh size, so things of a finite element approximation, U1 minus U2 times V1, okay? If you have the continuous solution, then this term is equal to zero. But we will not assume anymore that this time is equal to zero, but we will penalize the equation by this term. So by making h goes to zero, at the, in the limit, we will recover that U1 equal to U2. So this is a penalization, in fact, of the Dirichlet boundary condition. You do not impose it strongly, but only weakly. So you add those two terms. And so to do so, you have to have some test functions that are not zero on the boundary. Yes? So you have the terms appearing from the integration by parts here on sigma. And by adding these two formulation, you obtain this formulation. So this is the elliptic term, the term coming from the fact that you do not impose V1 equals zero and you do not impose V1 equals V2 on the interface. And so you have this term. Here we have used that the Neumann boundary conditions to write this term. And we have the penalization term here. And to make the formulation symmetric, we add this term, which is consistent. If U1 equals U2, this term cancel. So this is a consistent term, and it makes the formulation symmetric. Yes? And so this is a niche formulation. What can be said about this formulation? So consider finite element approximation. And you define the bilinear form. So the all the terms with enclosed by the red curve define the bilinear form. And the question is this bilinear form coercive? In order to have a well-posed problem, we need to have a coercive bilinear form. And the answer is yes, provided that gamma, so the parameter we have to fit, is large enough. So we add this term, and we will have to fit some gamma. And this gamma shall be large enough in order to ensure that A is coercive. Okay? And this gamma can be chosen independently of the H. So this is really important. You can choose the parameter gamma irrespectively of H to ensure the coercivity. So here we have a solution that is discontinuous at the interface because we don't enforce the strong continuity at the interface. We can have non-matching grids. Okay. And in fact, it corresponds to a discontinuous Galerkin method across the interface. So the idea was to apply this kind of method to the standard Dirichlet-Neumann splitting for fluid structure and see if, like that, it works, and if it works in an explicit way. Because what we want is to have an explicit scheme and to solve once per time step the fluid and once per time step the structure. Okay, so let's take a simple FSI model, linear one, where you have the Stokes system coupled to the 2D Stokes system coupled to 2D elasticity. So here I assume that the structure is thick, not thin one. So the equation of the structure is set in a 2D domain, but it will not change the analysis. You can do exactly the same with a thin structure. So coupling condition once again, equality of the action-reaction principle and equality of the velocity. So the idea is to enforce weakly the equality of the velocity instead of enforcing it strongly. Okay. So for the structure, the variational formulation, you take VH, which is not equal to zero at the interface. So you will see appearing the interface term there, sigma F. So first, this is when you integrate by parts, this is sigma S of DH dot N times WH. But due to the action-reaction principle, you can replace sigma S by sigma F and obtain this. And we add also the niche term to enforce weakly the equality of the velocity. And once again, this is a strongly consistent term because for the continuous solution, this term is equal to zero. And the fluid swap problem, we do exactly the same. So we take a test function VH. We have the same kind of boundary term as before. And we have this term that is the symmetric part of the other one there. And we enforce also in a weak way the equality of the velocity. Okay, so to summarize, we have so the scheme writes like that, and in red, so the scheme writes like that after semi-discretization in time. Here I discretize it in time. I once again I took a leapfrog scheme. And so the stars mean that you can choose the quantity at time n plus 1 or at time n. By choosing them at time n plus 1, you will have an implicit scheme. And by choosing them at time n, you will have an explicit scheme. So for the implicit scheme, you can prove that it is stable provided that you choose gamma large enough. So the drawback of this method is that we have to choose some parameter and to be sure that everything works well. So we have to tune some. So on sort les tournevis, quoi. And for the explicit coupling, then we have some spurs, because if you take P star to be equal to P n, then you will have some, so to take U star equal to U n in sigma f, this is okay. You will control this term. But by taking P star equal to Pn, we'll make appearing some porous term. And those porous terms takes the form of the difference of the pressure at time n plus 1 minus the pressure at time n. So the scheme, the explicit scheme, is not stable unless we control this quantity, which is the spurious energy at the interface. This is a quantity that lives on the interface sigma. So So the idea is to add this term to stabilize the scheme. You have a term that is that you don't know, you don't know how to control it, you will add it. And by adding it, so if you rewrite the strong equation associated to the weak formulation, then you see that the scheme can be expressed to a coupled free structure system where you solve the structure with Robin boundary conditions. So you have a linear combination of the normal component of the stress tensor and the structural velocity. So you solve, and in the right-hand side, you have the counterpart coming from the fluid at the previous time step. And so you solve the structural equation with Robin boundary condition, and then you solve the fluid equation with Robin boundary condition also. And by adding this stabilization term, you perturb the divergence equation. So in fact, you add some compressibility to the system. As I said before, by adding some compressibility to the system, you may shift the spectrum of the added mass effect. And so increase the range of stability of the scheme. So here, adding this term is in fact adding some compressibility, artificial compressibility, to your problem. So you are approximating the problem by adding some artificial compressibility. Yes? So here, what you can prove if that it is stable with the CFL condition, but this CFL condition is independent of the added mass effect. So independent of the ratio between the density of the fluid and the density of the structure, which is really a step further. Moreover, it is an explicit scheme. Nevertheless, you have had a lot of stabilization term everywhere to be sure it's stable. So it's not really accurate unless you do some correction, so defect correction, in order to be sure that the scheme is accurate. And this idea can also be extended to a projection scheme like Shorin-Tamim scheme, okay? So you can take the Shorin-Tamim thing I showed you before and treat it explicitly by adding by enforcing in a weak way the equality of the velocity and adding some compressibility, in fact, in order to control the spore stem. So here we go from Dirichlet-Neumann splitting, and the Dirichlet condition was enforced first in a strong way, then it was enforced in a weak way, and the final interpretation of the scheme is a Robin-Robin scheme. This is not anymore a Dirichlet-Neumann scheme, okay? So once again, by doing so, in fact, if we change the spectrum of the added mass operator and stuff like that, we are playing with that. And so, but here we have stability without any condition on the ratio of the densities. So to illustrate the fact that you have a lot of dissipation in for this scheme. So this is a displacement, an interface vertical displacement, where so the dots here, this is a reference configuration. In blue, you have so in black, you have implicit coupling scheme. So you see that the implicit coupling scheme is still far from the real the real implicit as a reference solution. So, but by decreasing the time step and the mesh size, then you will go, you will converge to the reference configuration. And so you see that the first, with zero correction, so the scheme I presented you, you dissipate a lot and you are really far from the reference configuration. But with an extrapolation and a correction, then you recover the behavior of the implicit scheme. So to design to design stable scheme is not the final issue, because by putting some stabilization term, you can have stable scheme. But next, you have to be accurate enough. And so to be accurate enough, you need to do some correction, extrapolation, and stuff like that. So, and so at least formally, you can compute the order of the scheme. And what you see is that if delta t is of order h, then you don't have a convergence of the scheme. So you need to impose a parabolic CFL type condition, which is not really satisfactory, to recover an optimal error. So we can think of other strategies. So here we enforce the niche methods in order to enforce in a weak way the equality of the velocity, and we add some, in the explicit scheme, we add some stabilization term on the pressure. If you consider 3D, 2D models, so 3D fluid coupled to a plate, for instance, or 2D, 1D model, so 2D fluid coupled to beam or wave equation and stuff like that, you can treat the structure as a generalized Robin condition. Why? Because so you have the equation of the structure. Okay, on the boundary, on sigma. But you know that U equal the velocity of the fluid on the boundary is equal to the velocity of the structure on the boundary. So if you discretize it like that, so you, d dot is the velocity of the structure minus d dot n over delta t plus l dn plus 1 minus sigma u n plus 1 pn plus 1 n. Then this quantity is equal to un plus 1, the trace of un plus 1 over sigma, and the trace of un over sigma over delta t. So here you have normal component of the stress of the fluid, sigma F. And here you have un plus 1. So this is a, by doing so, you have a general, after you have to express the n plus 1 in term of un plus 1, but you have a generalized Robin condition on the interface. But by doing so, you don't solve the structural equation. Okay? But you have a really strange boundary condition for the fluid. So this idea was used in a paper by Nobile and Vergara. And it was also used for the design of an explicit coupling scheme with a splitting on the structure operator. So I presented you a splitting on the fluid operator, but you can also think of split the structure operator. And so this is what I will present you right now. And it will be after, it will be the end. So take a thin structure and a fluid. So take, once again, a linear problem, the Stokes problem in a 2D domain coupled to the structure, so the same one as before, okay. Coupling condition, equality of the velocity. And so the idea is to write the structure equation as this equation. So to use the equality of the velocity and to replace u dt, the partial derivative with respect to t of the displacement by u in the structure equation. So you have this term there. Okay? Is it clear for the same time, same thing as there? And then to consider the fluid part with the discretization of those boundary conditions. Okay? So after discretization, what we have for boundary conditions on the fluid part, on the interface, is a Robin boundary condition. And so depending on the velocity of the structure at the previous time step and the elastic operator. And next, we will have to choose D star in order to have explicit, implicit, and scheme with correction, stuff like that. Okay. And next, what we solve is a structure part only the structure equation at time tn plus 1, remembering that, so with the notation that partial dt dn plus 1 is equal to the velocity of the structure at time. No, c'est pas ça. No, I made the mistake there. So this is the last equality is not true, I think, because you have the acceleration and the acceleration is not equal to a velocity. So there is something missing there. So it shall be I think something like that. So now you have replaced your system. Instead of solving fluid plus Dirichlet boundary condition and structure with a given force, you have replaced you solve the fluid plus Robin boundary condition coming from the equation of the structure. Okay, so the first remark is that the mass of the structure is then treated within the fluid. Okay? So now we can rewrite this system in two other formulations. So take the boundary condition satisfied by the fluid, and remember that D star solves the structure equation. So you replace LE of D star by the structure equation, but what corresponds to the structure equation. So what you obtain is in fact this condition, and you can also rewrite this as using this time the structure equation for dn plus 1. So you can start from the first boundary condition and write it like that. And so here what you see is that this is in fact a perturbation of the equality of the velocities at the interface, because you have d dot n plus 1 minus un plus 1 equals something that depends on the mechanical energy of the structure. So in fact, this scheme can be seen as an implicit scheme, because this is an implicit relation there. Even if I take d star to be equal to dn, this is an implicit condition. So I am enforcing in a way the equality of the velocity at time n plus 1 plus something. But we can rewrite, even in the explicit treatment, the scheme in an implicit manner with a term of perturbation. And so the underlying implicit scheme here is this one. So the fluid, then the structure, and boundary condition, kinematic boundary condition, so equality of the velocity at time n plus 1, which is satisfied, but with a perturbation term. And we will have to control this perturbation in order to have a stable scheme. So what are the choices for D star? So the first choice was made by Guibaudoni, Kanich, Glowinski, and they took D star equal to 0. So really simple scheme. And they proved that this scheme is stable. Next, Miguel Fernandez improved this result. And so he took d star equal to dn, or a first order extrapolation or a second order extrapolation. And the key issue to prove the stability of the scheme is to control the term coming from the additional term in the kinematic condition. So the answer is that we can control this additional term, but in every case. So in the second order extrapolation, you have to have some CFL condition in order to have a stable scheme. But you can control this extra term. But if you do an error analysis, then so R corresponds to the three case. So R equal to 0 in the first one, R equal 1 in the second one, and R equal 2 in the third one. So you see that if r equals 0, then you have a convergence in the square root of delta t. So the first scheme, in fact, is not really accurate. And in fact, so the first scheme is the pink one. So if you make the time step goes to zero and stuff like that, you recover some. So this is an example that has been picked up to show that the scheme is not accurate, but nevertheless. So once again, you have to in order to have, so you have a simple scheme that is stable, but it's not really accurate because you have too much dissipation in the system. And so you have once again to do something to recover some accuracy. And so with the incremental version of the scheme, you can recover some accuracy. So, je vais finir bien avant. So this can be generalized to a viscoelastic structure. So you had some viscosity on the structure. And the point is that, so in the paper of Ribononi, they treat this viscoelastic part in an implicit way. And in the paper of Fernandez and Jimmy Mulat, they treated the viscoelastic part in an explicit way. And in fact, it seems to be better from the accuracy point of view to treat the viscoelastic part in the explicit way, not in the implicit way. Moreover, it can be, so here it works really with, because we had a thin structure and we use the equality of the velocity at the boundary. And so we write the structure equation as a boundary condition for the fluid. But Miguel Fernandez generalized it to a thick structure. And so it can be written thanks to generalized Robin conditions. So you have the same kind. You have the, where it is. You have the same kind of Robin condition, but you have some operator that goes from the interface onto the domain. So the trouble is that since you have a thick structure, in the aeroelasticity, you have a loss of the square root of h, so h being the mesh size. And so there are many, many, many other splitting strategies. So you can design explicit scheme. Now the main point is the accuracy. The point is, design explicit scheme took, I don't know, 15 years, maybe. Because first, people didn't understood why explicit scheme didn't work. Then they develop implicit scheme. A lot. They develop methods to accelerate the convergence of implicit scheme, and Newton and quasi-Newton and stuff like that, preconditioners and stuff. But those were really expensive scheme. And then after, people start to understand why explicit scheme didn't work, mainly because of the added mass effects, mainly because of the incompressibility constraint. And so it took some time to understand how to design stable schemes. So the first step was just to split the added mass effect in two and then to control one part and to treat the other in an implicit way. And so after, okay, I can use Nitsch's method, but it's not stable, so I may add some stuff and stuff like that. So we can design explicit scheme, but now the real question is mostly accuracy. And there are many, many options from fully explicit to fully implicit. The implicit scheme are stable but expansive. The semi-implicit is stable but seems to depend on the ratio of the density, so it's not really satisfactory. The explicit scheme are stable but maybe and stable independently of this ratio but maybe not accurate. So it was a long story, and what I try to show you also is that they are linked between the strategy of proof of existence of weak or strong solution and the design of scheme, and that to understand the underlying continuous problem, unable to design correctly the numerical scheme, and in the reverse, you can try to prove existence, for instance, of weak solution by discretizing your system and making the discretize the parameter delta T and H go to zero, because if your scheme is correct, it will enable you to prove existence of weak solution. So you have some link between mathematical analysis and numerical analysis, and you have to see what is done in one part and in the other part in order to make further improvements. So thanks a lot.